Lacrosse Legends. Lacrosse Legends, a comprehensive look at America's greatest game, featuring legends past, present, and future.
Today, I'm Lacrosse Legend, Silverback Lacrosse President and CEO, Coach Larry Mackey.
Coach Larry Mackey, President of Silverback Lacrosse, Uganda U19 coach, Puget Sound Men's Lacrosse Club coach, the elite shot trainer from Silverback Lacrosse. The elite shot trainer, 6 feet high, but only 12 inches wide. Helping players develop a better and more accurate overhand shot.
Boy, route and my homie was my connect. Jealous, cause your bitch don't like me for being fresh. Little homie, don't trip, just lighting up on your step. Let that fofo spit, stop drooling up on yourself. I am on my shit, I'm standing up on myself. Got a Glock and 2 G's, not to mention the belt. You a bitch, straight cheese, I had you with you for help. I ain't got a pop E, I'm always feeling myself. Got mollies, oxys, I'm a pharmacy myself. Just waiting for payback, they say karma need my help. Straight shitting, when my feet get cold, I change coats. Fuck cold feet, your feet get broke for 8 notes. Only reason why you hiding me, you chain smoke. I've been horsing all these niggas for years. Case closed, shit pop, your face broke. See cops and straight bullet niggas. Ride, niggas get fried. The weight of my niggas ride. Hit them up, got them niggas like, damn, never hear the sound. They see him just hit the ground. Got them niggas like, oh my god. We gunning these niggas down. We running through niggas town for that bread. I am on my job. It's do a dive round off. That was me. I wouldn't let that shit slide. We gorilla
niggas. I close my eyes and Uganda. Why?
We caught up with Coach Mackey during his recent visit to New York.
I was on Facebook and I saw Uganda lacrosse. But I was like, yeah, right. I thought somebody was fishing. I reach out and I'm saying, you know, lacrosse in Uganda. Well, 2 months later, I ended up there. What intrigued me about the Uganda situation was they had a 51% AIDS rate. I lost both my parents to AIDS when I was a young soldier stationed at Fort Lewis. I wanted to go there for the lacrosse and I wanted to go there and see what they were doing to combat this epidemic, man. So been a relationship that I kept up with them since 2011.
This takes us back to when you first picked up a lacrosse stick.
It was seventh grade. Steve Davis was Huntington High School lacrosse coach and he was our gym teacher. As a seventh grader, he took our class out and taught us lacrosse. You know how lacrosse is with the brothers, man. Some of us don't like it, some of us do.
Right.
I loved it.
Right.
I loved it. I wasn't letting everybody know, but I was like, yo, this is dope. I ended up getting a lacrosse stick, but I didn't play till ninth grade. One of my buddies, he played basketball and the basketball coach asked him to come out and play lacrosse and bring a friend. And I was the friend, and I've been involved in it since then.
Jim Brown.
Yo, so I get introduced to lacrosse. I get a lacrosse stick. My parents was activists, knowledge of self, you know, activist type, especially my pops. So I came in the house, and I was like, Mom, Dad, I want to play lacrosse. And my mom was like, oh, hell no. My mom was like, my skinny baby out there with 19 white boys with sticks, that sounds like a lynching. You know what I'm saying? My mom was against it. My dad, now, enough respect, my father was a third degree black belt in Shotokan. So I've been learning how to fight since I was young. So he was like, I ain't worried about him. Let him go play that. You know what I'm saying? Because my father, he kind of felt like the future would be different for me than it was for him. You know, he was from Florida. He lived through Jim Crow and all that. He said, No, your future is going to be different. And maybe playing that game would help you make connections that I would never make. One, and two, he said the ultimate. Jim Brown played it. I was like, Jim Brown? Because, yo, to my father, and then he translated it to me, Jim Brown was soul brother number one, man.
Yes, sir.
Jim Brown would like, my father would be like, Jim fights for our people. You know, he's conscious about our folks. You know what I'm saying? He cares. You know, when people say Jim Brown, obviously I grew up, it was like the 70s and 80s. You see the old footage, but I always think of Jim Brown. I always think of three the hard way. Right. You know, Jim Brown shooting 12 Nazis with a with a six shooter. Right. You know what I mean? Right. I always think of that and the Dirty Dozen.
Right.
You know, so he was always a hero in our household. But then to know that he played this game that not a lot of brothers played, mm-hmm. that must have took heart on his part.
Right.
And my father was like, yo, if you got the heart to do that, like Jim Brown had the heart to do that, I support you playing that game. And so enough respect that I got out there. And you get punched in the mouth, but right. I had to get up every time because Jim Brown would get up every time.
That's right.
You know, so that's why I love that dude, man. Playing lacrosse at Huntington High School on Long Island gave me the love for the game. The guys that I played with, my coaches and everything, made sure that I loved it, man. And I wasn't that good, but I loved it, you know. I played JV for a year, then I played varsity for 2 years. After I graduated high school, no colleges was calling. I ended up enlisting in the military. I was stationed over in Korea for a year. 9 months in, you get your orders to go where you're going. And I got orders for Fort Lewis, Washington. Now, I'm from Long Island. Only Washington that I know is D.C. Right. So I was like, D, I'm going to see Maryland. I'm going to see Hopkins. I was happy, right? One of my sergeants was like, no. Here's D.C. Here's where you're going. And he pointed to me on the map, and I started literally crying. Because, you know, I lost my parents, and I wanted to be back close to home, you know what I'm saying? Enough respect, I'm going up to Seoul, Korea. I met a sergeant from Georgia, and I was, you know, I was still sad, still had dry tears on my face. Right. He was like, young man, what's wrong? And I told him, he said, Fort Lewis is one of the greatest places to get stationed in the military. And I was like, really? He was like, man, before you give it a, before you, you know, dismiss it, man, go embrace it. I get there and it's exactly what he said, man. I was having fun, but I didn't have any lacrosse. You know, I brought my lacrosse stick because I would meet officers from West Point and play catch sometimes. Well, I met a friend. I was driving trying to find her house and I got lost and I'm looking up to my right and I saw a lacrosse goal and I went bananas. I forgot all about my friend. Whipped my car in the parking lot, ran up the hill that where the lacrosse goal was and started shooting on it. And you ever seen one of the movies where the wrong dude step into the party and the DJ scratches the record? Right. That's kind of how it felt when the team came out. But the team came out and they sat there and watched me for a minute shooting on the goal. One of the kids came over and he said, where are you from that you know how to play? And I'm arrogant. I'm from Long Island. You country boys, you know what I'm saying? What do you know about this thing? And it turned out that I got to play lacrosse for the University of Puget Sound. Played for them for 2 years while I was an enlisted man at Fort Lewis. And what was really cool is my commander was from West Point. So he would have my company come out and watch me play. You know, which is a story in itself, hopefully we get to, that's pretty much how my progression from high school to Fort Lewis happened, and playing in the Army happened.
Can you tell us the difference between the Ugandan national team and the Ugandan U19 team?
The national team are the men's team. The U19 team is the high school kids who are eventually gonna be that men's team. The initial team that started for Uganda was the men's national team, and that's the team that went to the World Games in 2014, and then went to the next World Games in 2018. You know, these kids, they're the kids, man. They're the ones that are looking to replace the kids who have been the national team. So they're building up to that, and they're going to get this World Game and World Team experience. And that's the difference, man. You got the men, and then you got the boys who are looking to be a replace those men.
Next on Lacrosse Legends. You're watching Lacrosse Legends.
Like an African
drum. The only other hands did a touch before young was a guala out of Dallas with a shag like Tum Tum. Back to the hood with it, niggas thought I detox until I hit them corners with that motherfucking sheetrock. The rollers back, bitch, the CF on the back, bitch. The 6-3 highlight is the difference like an asterisk. Yes, the re-up gang never dies. Soda makes a brick multiply. Push tons, a monster with the pie. Keep water from the villain. Remember what it did to them gremlins? Oh God, street wars when the heat warms up. It's summertime, niggas know what's up. Heavy armor, heavy drama, heavy commas. Be the reason haters scared of us fucking they baby mamas.
Each and every product hits the street. You know they will be strong. They'll be dancing to the beat of this drum. The sun, it's addiction, hey. You know we got them hooked like thieves. They open like a trunk. They'll be dancing to the beat of this drum. Hey.
Yeah, I told Pusha I told Mal that Vinny moved more white shit than a snowplow. Everybody knew the guinea was so foul. The SKS with the bayonet, oh wow. I rob everything and leave you with a hungry gut. The hollow tips leave you looking like you got a Gumby cut. You think you fucking with the guard, then use a funny fuck. Rambo knife, cut your stomach like a tummy tuck. All you see is darkness when the gun bursts. The G36 melts your brain like a pun verse. I act wild, but I handle my funds first. I'm drunk all the time, blood quenches the sun thirst. I don't talk about the money I got, because if money want my money, then money gets shot. Rap shit don't work, then I dumb on the block. We're pushing in mile, cooking up the gems in the pot.
She knows this product hits the street. You know they will be strong. They'll be dancing to the beat of this drum. The sun, it's addiction, hey. You know we got them hooked like thieves. They open like a trunk. They'll be dancing to the beat of this drum. It's a addiction, hey.
Still with the coke, man. Same as it ever was. Re-up gang, we the shame of America. 80s hysteria, the king been my legacy. The feds got our names, they hang us in effigy. Best believe it, come back like it never left. I write rhymes, but I bet I'd make a better chef. They can't wait for it to dry, they like it better wet. And I'm heavy with the D like Eddie F. I whip it good, real good, then I let it rest. Then I scrape the sides, then I let them test. Yes, I got weight like creatine. The gym star hit that chopping block like a guillotine. Nah, I mean, sitting on chrome rims. Not only paper, we stack brick like Stonehenge. Go against us, haters got no wins. I trust no one and I don't need no friends.
What is your personal message to Ugandans to get them to come to the team?
It's an opportunity. Lacrosse got me to your country. What will lacrosse do for you? I'm a kid from the projects. I never expected to be in Africa, let alone with a lacrosse stick. Listen, execute, and dream.
Right.
And if you can do those three things, you can do anything. And the fact that you're getting a chance to play the creator's game, it can take you anywhere.
So what's your vision for the Ugandan U19 team?
Enough respect to it. It's not just my vision. Mm-hmm. It's the vision of the ULA, the Ugandan Lacrosse Association. The vision is that we have to be able to sustain lacrosse in Uganda without as much outside assistance as we're getting. If you're getting assistance from the outside, then they can quickly say, well, we're not going to do this. If you want to be independent like that, you have to find a way to make yourselves important and make this game important, not just to you for the fun of it, but to your country. I lost my parents to AIDS, as I mentioned before. I said, why don't we work towards the fight of AIDS? Why don't we make our cause fighting against AIDS and finding resources for AIDS research? And they agreed, and that's kind of the basis of what we're gonna do as far as where the U19 team is going.
Right.
And we have some special things happening behind that.
So can you give us an example of what you're gonna do for the future?
Can't do that, but I can say, we have some serious blessings that have come our way. We have some people who see our vision and are behind us. It's all blessings, man. So just follow us, brother. Just okay. Keep, you know, I've actually put it online that you should keep your eyes on Uganda Lacrosse, because we're going in a direction that I think it's going to surprise you.
Next on Lacrosse Legends. You're watching Lacrosse Legends.
Told you guys that I played lacrosse for this University of Puget Sound. In the military, I had a lot of dudes from the South, you know, a lot of black men from the South. And I was the first person they'd ever seen carrying a lacrosse stick. So, man, you know how you can get it.
Yeah,
you know,
well,
you
yeah.
ain't real, blah, blah, blah. Right. I had to deal with all that.
Right.
Well, my unit had to go to the field the weekend of the 89 championship, Hopkins, Syracuse, right?
Right.
I had a sergeant in my unit. I said, you know, Sergeant Smith, I'm going to be gone. I'm hurt. You know, I want to watch the game. It's on ESPN. Would you record it for me? And he did. I got back a couple of weeks later. I sat and watched the game with him, and he had never seen anybody else besides me with a lacrosse stick.
You're too full because your mic is shot.
Mr. Rodney Dempsey, one of the best lacrosse players to ever come out of Fort Washington, Long Island. Dempsey possessed both speed and a quick rifle shot, helping take Syracuse lacrosse program to new heights. Dumpson's game-winning goal secured the victory for Syracuse Orangemen in the 1989 championship game for John.
I knew I was the man with the master plan to make it to the
gate. It's over to Dumpson, who takes the bad pass, makes one move, and fires the shot for his second goal, believe, of the day. Second goal for Dumpson.
And 16th goal of the season.
And Paul Gate, I think, is 4-2 on the day.
So when he saw Rodney Dumpson, he was like, oh my God, brother. And Rodney scored them last goals.
Right.
Man, you should have seen the pride in his chest, you know, seeing Rodney do that. So he would come out to my game. He went from being totally uninterested to wanting to see what it was about. I went to our arm, to the day room for our company. And I put the seat, it was VHS tape. Mm-hmm. I put it in the VCR, right. Old school, right. And I just let the game play and I sat back. And them same dudes who was letting me have it about playing lacrosse were watching the game and they were in it. And as soon as they saw Rodney Dumpson, bro, they was like, oh my God, yo, look at dude, blah, blah. And remember, there was 50,000 people in that crowd.
Right.
So the big thing now, there ain't no professional lacrosse. You know, right, you a right, sucker right. for playing that. Well, right. They saw them 50,000 people like, whoa, this brother's playing in front of 50,000 people. And he scored them goals, bro.
Right.
You could feel the pride in the room. It was like palatable, you know, you could cut it with a knife, so to speak, man. Wow. You could feel when they saw that dude. And when I watched your episode with him, I just wanted to tell him, man, thank you.
Right.
Thank you for being out there and doing what you did, man, because you turned a lot of brothers on to the creator's game who normally wouldn't have watched, and they would come out and watch me play, man.
Oh.
So I wanted to spread that to him.
Nice.
Thank you.
Yeah. So what's your future in lacrosse?
Right now, brother, I'm having a ball coaching the University of Puget Sound lacrosse. We're an MCLA club team, so we're not an NCAA college team, but we are a college team. Just being able to go back to where I played when I was in the military has been a blast. I was an enlisted sergeant. I get to go play college lacrosse and then come back 30 years later and I get to coach the team that I played college lacrosse for. This has been amazing. And the funny thing is, I told you kind of the story of how I was driving along and saw the goal.
Mm-hmm.
I take that drive every day that I'm going to practice. Every day I get to relive that. It's been so satisfying, man. And the cool thing is the boys that I'm coaching right now, they just want to play. My team is small, but they're so dedicated. So it's just been such an experience. And as far as Uganda, I can't let the cat out the bag on that
right.
one. But right. I will tell you, keep your eyes on us, man. And
for sure.
I may go back, you know, if they call me to go mm-hmm. back over to UG to see what's going on or
right.
whatever. But I don't have any plans of staying there and running things. I want to come back here, man. My heart is here in America, in the inner
right.
city where I grew up. Oh, like
right.
I came to Hempstead
right.
that time
that's
to
right.
help out. That's the kind of stuff that I want to do, you know what I'm saying? I'll empower them as much as I can to do their own thing and watch that grow from afar. I don't
right.
need to be there controlling anything. I want to be here, empower the people that I grew up with who are like me. That's kind of what I'm praying that the future holds. Coach my college team as long as I can, help my community and help all underserved kids as much as I can.
What can we expect from the Puget Sound lacrosse team in 2020?
Our season just started. This team hadn't won a game in 2 years. We lost our first game 5-4 to a pretty powerful Western Washington team. We picked up our first win a week ago, 21-6 over Southern Oregon. Man, they were a pretty powerful team. What you can expect to see is these dudes work hard. We'll let the chips fall where they may. I want to bring back the level of swag that we had when I was playing 30 years ago for this team, because we had a swag to us. We talk about the three important things: listen, execute, and dream. So you can expect us to work hard and do that.
You're the first African-American coach to coach an African team.
Yes.
You're the first African-American coach to coach UPS.
Yes.
It must come with some pressure.
Absolutely. But to me, pressure is inherent with wanting to be successful.
This is Bernard Williams for Lacrosse Legends.
Football didn't change until Bear Bryant asked USC, who had a black quarterback and a black fullback, to come to Alabama and play. And when that USC team came and won, that changed college football, because the people of Alabama, even though through all the turmoil that was going on there as far as our people are concerned, they were like, maybe we should have a Bam Cunningham in our backfield. Change college football. Well, West Texas won an NCAA championship in basketball.
Right.
Changed college basketball. So I feel like I've been handed an instrument of change with these African team that I have. You know, so I feel like my job is to push the ball further, man, to try to get them to a level where they're competing so well that it attracts us, it attracts underserved kids, and it helps change the game, you know. And as far as my college team, the pressure is to change the atmosphere there. You know, they haven't won in a couple of years, so I had to come in and pump them up like you would do soldiers. You know, we're going in, we have to look at everything like we're going into battle.
Right.
You know, and it's not so much that we're winning because I have an ego and we have to win. It's more, I want my kids to feel what I felt 30 years ago, because our team used to win a lot.
Right.
You know, so I want my kids to feel that. And that's kind of my idea behind coaching, is I want my kids to feel like winners, you know, and be able to deal with adversity. The thing about sports is, you're safely taught how to deal with adversity. So when it comes time where you may lose your house or something like that, you don't freak out and go shoot up the mall.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? You know, okay, I've been through adversity before. I stand my ground. I think it through. I do what I got to do and I execute. And I know it can change if I work hard. Where else do you get a chance where else do you get a safe place to do that besides sports? You know, and again, as an African American, knowing that if your team wins, our people like winners. Everybody likes winners, but you can see historically what winning has done for the major sports that we like to play.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I would like lacrosse to be a sport that we like to play. Somebody's got to go win.
That's right.
So when you are given an instrument of change, you bust your behind to make sure you change the atmosphere with that instrument.
Right.
That's kind of my view of it.
Gotcha.
So there's pressure, man. There's pressure. And I think that pressure comes because of the people whose shoulders I'm standing on.
Right.
In my humble opinion. I rap on this production. I touch something, trust nothing. Iron lung, twisted metal. I see him ducking. My dark gun, busting from every angle. Worldwide total carnage. The sickest flow. That be cold name, Agent Orange. Killing you slow. It's only right you pay homage to those that's about to blow like that shit up your nose. As a rock when I strike talking, herbound, be screaming on you like a drill sergeant. Herbounds got me where I wanna be right now. Don't know the time, check the hour on your sundown. Watch me shine, jump off a cheap wine. Each line be on point when I speak mine. On behalf of my crew, into the room, 36 more deadly chambers to take you through.